And now I'll get to the significant part of my presentation, which is to, if you'll allow me to present, a hellraiser extraordinaire who drives the coke-headed corporate plutocrats crazy. Of course, that's a pretty short ride for a good number of them. But I think of Bernie Sanders as Tim Carpenter with a Bronx accent and a Senate seat. unlike way too many middle-of-the-road, don't-rock-the-boat, pusillanimous corporate Democrats, pusillanimous is my new favorite word, look it up, it's a clean word. Bernie didn't go to Washington just to hold a Senate seat, just to sit in it, but to stand on it and to thrust it at the corporate kleptocrats, to wield it like a lion tamer at the Wall Street barons. Social Security, Bernie says, don't shrink it, expand it. Medicare, yes, for everybody. Wall Street, bust them up, says Bernie, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. There's a little motel down the street from where I live in Austin, Texas, called the Austin Motel. It's got a great old marquee out front, and it says, no additives, no preservatives, corporate free since 1938. that could be our man. From being a progressive mayor of Burlington, Vermont, being a member of Congress and in the Progressive Caucus from Vermont, to being a Vermont senator, strongly progressive, to being our candidate for President of the United States in 2016. Here's Bernie Sanders.
Hello. Thank you very much for coming out this morning. And Jim, thank you not only for your wonderful introduction, but thank you for the work that you have been doing for decades now. Progressive politics is not just about urban America. It's about rural America, places in Texas, places in Vermont. And more than almost anybody I know, Jim Hightower has been there fighting the fight, and we appreciate that so much, Jim. I'll tell you what I wanted to do this morning is to kind of bore you a little bit. Jim got you riled up, and I'm going to calm you down a little bit, because what I wanted to do is to try to explain. And we can't do this in TV on 12-second sound bites. Kind of talk about how we got to where we are today as a nation and where we have got to go, in my view. You know, if you go into a doctor's office and you're not feeling well, what you want is a good diagnosis. You don't want the doctor to tell you everything is great or here's an aspirin. You kind of want to know what's going on and you want to figure out how we go from here to there. So I want to talk a little bit about public policy, what's going on in this country. And what I'm going to tell you is not what you're going to be hearing on CBS or NBC or ABC too often. And I'm going to talk about politics, which is how we move together to improve life in the United States. But let me just start off with some political, and a lot of the stuff, I'm going to throw out some facts and figures to you, and we'll have that up on our website, sanders.senate.gov. So check it out if you want to. But I want to start off with issues, political issues, and the issue of political consciousness in America. There was a poll done about a year ago by Monmouth University in New Jersey, and they asked the American people, they said, tell me which political party controls the U.S. House of Representatives and the U.S. Senate. Which political party? 63% of the American people did not know the answer to that question. Now, statistically, you start off at about, you know, you can make a guess, Democrats control both, Republicans control both, whatever it may be, but only 37% of the people knew that information. If you go out around America and you say, hey, tell me the name of your member of Congress, Democrat, Republican, Independent, whatever, I would suspect the vast majority of the American people don't know who their member of Congress is. There is an election, as all of you know, very important election coming up in November. We'll decide who controls the House of Representatives, who controls the Senate. What the pundits tell us is that in that election, 60% of the American people will not vote. 60%, 40% will vote. In some states, the number obviously will be higher, in some states will be lower. If you appreciate that 60% of the people are not going to vote, what I can tell you is that among low-income and working people, that number will be 70 or 80% not voting. You got it? So you're a democratic society, and 70, 80% of the people are not going to participate in that very, very important election, which determines who controls the Congress. And then in terms of other aspects of that election, what we know right now is the Koch brothers, among others, will be spending many, many hundreds of millions of dollars to elect right-wing candidates. So, most people don't know who controls the House or the Senate, and many people, I've had it to me, people say, all of you, you're all terrible, throw them all out. Doesn't matter, you know, Bernie Sanders, Elizabeth Warren, Ted Cruz, whatever, throw them all out, they're all the same. There are millions of people who have that level of consciousness, okay? And then the vast majority of working people, lower income people, don't vote. And then the billionaire class funds their candidates. And then you got a media out there, corporately owned media, which will define the issues that we are allowed to discuss and will give us 8 seconds on TV to talk about complicated issues. That is the overall landscape politically that we have got to address. And as I think of Tim Carpenter and the courage that he showed throughout his entire life fighting through disease, the truth of the matter is to take that political reality on is that we need a million Tim Carpenters. We need people who are prepared. Who are prepared to understand that what happens politically is of enormous consequence. You know it. That's why you're here on a Saturday morning. Most people don't. So you can strike up a serious discussion about how the Celtics are doing, about how the Patriots are doing. Much harder to strike up a serious discussion about what trade policy means to American workers or the growing wealth and income inequality in America. So when we talk about political revolution, what we talk about is changing the political culture of this country and, in fact, making the average American understand that democracy is a very big deal, and he and she has to participate in the process if we're going to save this country and protect our kids, our grandchildren, and the planet. Now, how you do that? How you do that ain't easy. It's easy for me to give you some fine words up here, but in reality, it is a lot, it is hard stuff. What Tim has done, have to deal with all kinds of people. Well, I only agree with you 98% of the time, not good enough. How do you bring people together? Second of all, how do you go outside of your zone of comfort? It is easy for everybody to talk to their friends who agree on the vast majority of the issues. It is not so easy to agree to talk with people who have given up on the political process, don't vote, or people who will disagree with you on this or that issue. How, in an intelligent way, do you reach out, bring people together? Not so easy, but that is exactly the struggle that we faced. And I will tell you this also, that no matter who the next president of the United States is, this I say with absolute certainty, if that president is serious about addressing the huge crises facing this country, that president cannot do it unless there is a political revolution in this country, because the opposition is so powerful, so strong, that what you need to do is not sit around a room arguing with members of Congress. You got to do that too. You got to negotiate. You do have to do that. But you have to say to your political opponents in the Capitol, guess what? There are 5 million people out there who want me to address wealth and income inequality. There are 3 million people out there who demand that we address the crisis of climate change. There are 2 million students out there marching on Washington who say that you have got to do something about the high cost of college and student indebtedness. That is the way you make change. But that requires a whole lot of work. A whole lot of work. Now, what I want to do now is to give you my sense of what's going on in America today. And I begin by saying to you that I think this country today has more serious problems than at any time since the Great Depression of the 1930s. And if you add there the planetary crisis of climate change, it may well be that this moment in history is more difficult perhaps than any time since the Civil War in the United States of America. So we have a whole bunch of problems out there. Ain't easy stuff, but the future of the nation, and in fact, given America's position in the world, the future of the world, depends upon us getting it right, understanding what's going on, and then figuring out how we move forward. There are a lot of people out there who are angry. Some of them are in the Tea Party, some of them are in Occupy Wall Street. What are they angry about? Well, let me tell you what they're angry about. Since 1999, median family income in this country has gone down by $5,000 since 1999. That is that family right in the middle who may be working longer hours. Right now you have two breadwinners, maybe you used to have one. What they have seen is working longer hours for lower wages. Median family income, despite a huge increase in productivity, median family income has gone down. You know what that means? It means people now have the tools through new technology to produce more, and yet they are getting less. You want to see why? You see these white guys out there who are angry? This is why they're angry. That median male worker, that average guy out there, made $283 less last year than he did 44 years ago in inflation accounted for dollars. You got that? That's why these guys are angry. They're saying, I'm working my tail off, and I'm falling behind. How does that happen? Typical female workers earned $1,700 less last year than that woman did in 2007. And here's something that should get everybody very, very nervous. Over half of all Americans have less than $10,000 in savings. All right? Do you know what that means? Do you know what anxiety that means? That means that that person is one illness away from financial disaster, right? Doctor says, you know, Mrs. Smith, I have some bad news for you. And she only has $8,000 in the bank. You are a divorce away from disaster. You are an automobile accident away from disaster. Your car breaks down. You need a new vehicle. You don't have the money to get to work to take care of your family. When you talk about a stressed out nation, you have millions and millions of people living on the edge. You are 63 years of age and you got $8,000 in the bank. That is what is going on in our country today. Today, we have some 7 million young people. These are kids who have either dropped out of high school or have graduated high school. And you know what they're doing right now? Very little. They are hanging out on street corners in Massachusetts and in Vermont. Some of them are engaging in destructive activity or self-destructive activity, drugs, crime, petty crime. And the end result of all of that stuff is that we have more people in jail today than any other country on earth. China is a communist authoritarian country, not a pleasant place politically, much larger than the United States. We have more people behind bars than China does, which tells me maybe it's better to invest in our kids than invest in jails. And when you talk about the decline of the middle class, the collapse of the middle class, understand this. Since 2001, in our country, we have lost over 60,000 factories. Now, the young people may not know it, but there was once a time when in America we actually produced products. I know you don't believe me, but it's true. And then not everything came from China and countries all over the world. So since 2001, we have lost 60,000 factories and millions of good-paying jobs. Now, working in a factory has always been tough work. It's not glamorous work, it's not glorious work. But when you had a strong manufacturing sector in America, working class people could earn decent wages with decent benefits, and if they had a union behind them, they might have a pension program as well and be able to send their kids to college. Not so many years ago, the largest private sector employer in the United States was General Motors. Decent wages, good union, good benefits. Today, the largest private sector employer in America is Walmart, low wages, anti-union, minimal benefits. In one phrase, the transition from General Motors to Walmart tells you most of what you need to know about what's happened to the middle class and the United States economy. And those of you who have gray hair know this. 30 years ago, the United States led the world in terms of the percentage of our people who graduated college. We were the best educated country on earth. Not everybody went to college 30 years ago, for sure, but we led the world. Today, we are in about 12th place and falling further and further behind. So you have countries in the world that have the sense to know that in a highly competitive global economy, you invest in your kids, you invest in education, and you say to the young people of your country that if you have the ability, you are going to go to college. In this country right now, we are saying exactly the opposite. If you are a bright, serious young person from a low-income family or a working-class family, the truth is, it is very hard for you to go to college, and if you go to college, you're gonna face the reality that you may end up $50,000, $60,000 in debt. You go to graduate school, make that $100,000 or more in debt. What sense is that? So in terms of the global economy, world's economy, we are falling further and further behind many other countries in terms of our ability to educate our people and think long-term what that means to our position on this planet. Now, I've talked a bit about what is going on to the middle class of this country, which is disappearing. Among low-income people, the fact is that we have more people living in poverty today, over 46 million, than any time in the history of the United States. More people. At 22%, we have by far the highest rate of childhood poverty of any major country on earth. So that's what's going on for the vast majority of the people. And you look out there and you say, why are people so angry? Why are they lashing out? Or why have people given up on the political process? And when you hand them a leaflet, they say, leave me alone, they're all crooks. I don't want to participate in it, it's all a fraud. Why is that? And the reality is obviously government has failed the vast majority of our people. But importantly, there is another reality taking place which also has to be explored. It is not like some terrible hurricane or flood or disaster has impacted the United States of America and everybody is hurting. That is not the case. The reality is that while the middle class disappears and more people live in poverty than any time in history, the reality is that while real unemployment is close to 12%, youth unemployment close to 20%, the real reality is that the people on top are doing better than in any time in the history of our country. And that's also why people are furious. It's not happening to everybody. You're not in the midst of some depression where everybody is hurting. vast majority of people are hurting. People on top are doing phenomenally well. Now, again, I'm going to give you some statistics which do not get onto television. Basically, you don't. You don't get in radio. We're going to talk about that, because when you talk about a political revolution and things we have to do, anyone who thinks you don't have to deal with media would be very mistaken. In terms of distribution of wealth today, top 1% owns 38% of the financial wealth of America. Okay? That's a lot. Who wants to guess what the bottom 60% of the American people own? Oh, you looked at my website. You were here last night. They cheated. 2.3%. Oh, you got that? Top 1% owns 38%. Now, that's a startling figure. But more startling is the fact that the bottom 60% combined own 2.3% of the wealth of America. The top family in America, the wealthiest family in America, is the Walton family that owns Walmart. We'll talk about Walmart for a bit. They own more wealth than the bottom 40% of American society. One family. Charles and David Koch, you all know the Koch brothers, and I want to talk about them later in another context. But they hate President Obama because he's destroying the American free enterprise system, and he's just a radical communist and whatnot. But despite the oppressive nature of the federal government in trying to destroy business in America, they made, last year, in 1 year, their wealth went up from $68 to $80 billion in 1 year. $12 billion increase in wealth. Sheldon Adelson, you may remember Sheldon, he's a little bit jealous of the Koch brothers. He's only worth $38 billion. And he has this inferiority complex. The other guys are worth $80 billion. And Sheldon held his own, in order to respond, he held his own primary in Las Vegas last month. I'm going to talk about that later. But this is where we are in terms of American politics. What he said, if you are interested in running as a Republican for President of the United States, drop in and see me in Las Vegas. And if I like what you're saying to me, I may give you a few $100 million for your campaign, or more. So I've got $23 billion. I can spend it. His wealth increased last year also in a very significant way. In terms of income, wealth is what people accumulate in their lifetime. In terms of income, since the Wall Street collapse, 95% of all new income generated goes to the top 1%. How's that? 95% of all new income. So millions of people seeing a decline in their income, 95% of that new income is going to the top 1%. Top 25 hedge fund managers last year made $24 billion. 25 guys. And most of them were guys. Made $24 billion. That is equivalent to the full salaries of more than 425,000 public school teachers. Got it? We don't have enough money for public education. Isn't that too sad? And yet 24 hedge fund managers made more money than 425,000 public school teachers. Today, corporate profits are at an all-time high, and CEOs make more than 300 times than their average employees. Now, we hear a whole lot about our oppressive tax system, how we're just strangling business. Each and every year, we lose $100 billion or more because large corporations stash their money in the Cayman Islands and in Bermuda and other tax havens in order to avoid American taxes. In fact, one out of four major corporations in this country pays zero in federal income taxes. Over the past 5 years, corporations like General Electric, Boeing, and Verizon paid zero in federal income tax, even though all of those companies made a combined profit of $78 billion. They pay nothing in taxes because they write the tax code through their lobbyists and have hundreds of lawyers out there knowing how to take advantage of the tax code that they write. Now, in the last couple of years, we have heard a whole lot about our Republican colleagues' concerns about the deficit. And what the Ryan budget, you all know what the Ryan budget is, that's the budget passed by the US House of Representatives, Republican House. And what they argue is that the budget deficit is just too big. Therefore, we have to cut Medicare, Medicaid, nutrition programs, huge cuts in food stamps, education, and any and every program that working families enjoy, because the deficit is just so big. How do we get into this deficit, which, by the way, has been significantly reduced in the last 5 years, significantly reduced? How do we get into that deficit? Now, you are looking, you know, when you're on television, you say, I am a deficit hawk, and I know it's hard, but we have to have the courage to cut Social Security and Medicare and programs for hungry children. We have to make tough choices because the deficit is just unsustainable. You heard that speech a few thousand times? Well, what you should know is that the deficit was caused, they weren't so worried about the deficit when they went to war in Afghanistan and Iraq. In fact, they forgot about how you pay for those wars. Now, I voted against the war in Iraq, and I think that history... and I think that history will clearly recognize that as the right vote, but forget that for a moment. Just look at the financial issue. These guys were so worried about the deficit that, unlike previous wars where presidents said, you know, we're gonna go to war, it's an expensive proposition, we're gonna have to raise taxes, under Bush, not only did we not raise taxes, we lowered taxes. We passed a Medicare Part D prescription drug program written by the pharmaceutical industry, and Bush and the other deficit hawks forgot to pay for it. The end result of it is that a significant surplus left to Bush by the Clinton administration became a huge deficit. And then, under the guise of the need for deficit reduction, these guys want to cut every program that working families enjoy. Let me tell you what I think has to be done right now. What are the issues and what is the agenda that progressives need to hear? First of all, we have made significant progress in deficit reduction. We did it the wrong way. The progress has made. The issue out there, if you ask any American, and every poll says it, they say, tell me, what do you think is the major issue? And what do people say? Jobs, jobs, and jobs. And the reason for that is twofold. Real unemployment is not 6.3%. If you look at people who are working part-time when they want to work full-time, if you look at people who have given up looking for work, do you know what real unemployment is in America today? It's close to 12%, all right? So what people are saying, we have to create millions of jobs. And one way you do that very quickly, according to the economists, is by rebuilding our crumbling infrastructure. And you create all kinds of jobs. It's not just blue-collar jobs. What it is you got roads and bridges and water systems. I just talked to the mayor of Northampton right here. And I don't know about him. When I was mayor of Burlington, believe me, we had infrastructure problems. Water systems, very expensive propositions. Our rail system, compared to Europe, Japan, China, is falling further and further behind. So if you invest in rebuilding our crumbling infrastructure, you can create, according to the economist, millions of jobs. And, by the way, if we listen to what the scientific community tells us, and that is that climate change is real, that it is already having devastating impacts, that the future of the planet depends upon us substantially and radically reducing greenhouse gas emissions and moving to energy efficiency, moving to weatherization, moving to sustainable energy. If we do that, we can also create millions of jobs. But we have got to address the jobs issue. But at a time when many of the new jobs being created are low wage and part-time, we have also got to have a vision which says that anybody who works 40 hours a week in this country is not going to live in poverty, which means we need to have a minimum wage, which is a living wage. A couple of weeks ago, we had on the floor of the Senate a bill which would have raised the minimum wage from nationally, 7.25 to 10.10. Is 10.10 enough? No. Is it a good start? Yes. We managed to get all of one Republican to vote for that bill. Terms of education. Well, I mentioned before the problem, but this is what we, in my view, have got to recognize. Every psychologist who has studied the issue tells us that the most significant years of a human being's life are 0 to 3. All right? Everybody knows that. And yet we have childcare workers in this country who make lower wages than McDonald's workers. So what we have got to do is to say to working families, and this is true in Vermont and it's all over this country, you're a mom and a dad and you're going out to work, you want to make sure that your son or daughter has high quality childcare. Childcare that you can afford. So what we have got to do is make sure that every family in this country has high quality childcare at an affordable cost. And we have to say that our childcare workers are as important as our college professors, and I know I say this. And they should be able to be proud of the career that they have on that enormously important and difficult work. They should be well paid and well trained and well respected. Not as a castaway, oh, you're going to do childcare for a few years until you do something important. Not the case. And in terms of college education, I believe that there are kids right now in Northampton, Burlington, Vermont, wherever, who by the time they are 9 or 10 years of age really understand what's going to happen to their lives. They understand whether they're going to have an opportunity to make it into the middle class or whether they're going to continue to live in poverty. It would be of profound importance if we were able to say to every child in America, every teacher in America, that if your kid is serious and that kid studies hard and has the ability and desire to go to college, that regardless of the income of his or her family, that kid is going to go to college and get the best education we can provide him. And that will impact not just higher education. It'll impact kids in the middle schools, in elementary schools, who now understand that if they do their work, they are going to make it into the middle class and get a good education. Now, there is an attack taking place on every single program, of significance to working families. Every important piece of legislation passed since Franklin Delano Roosevelt was president in the 1930s is now under assault. Now, I want to give you some good news here and to tell you how I think we organize effectively. 3-4 years ago, you could not turn on your television without hearing the following. Sadly, Social Security is going broke. And given the huge deficit that we have, and given our desire to really save Social Security, sadly, we're going to have to make cuts in Social Security. Those were the brave people. The cowardly people said, well, I think we need entitlement reform, which is a fancy word for saying cuts in Social Security. Every Republican in Congress, or maybe a few not, but virtually every Republican supported that position. Some Democrats supported that position. And the President of the United States supported that position through the concept of a chained CPI, which is a fancy term for cuts in cost of living adjustments, called significant cuts in Social Security. That's where we were 3 years ago. Everybody, I remember watching Meet the Press or whatever it is on Sunday, and the guy says, well, the commentator says, this was media. Well, we all know that Social Security is going broke. What are you going to do about it? Well, I don't know. All right, facts. Social Security today has approximately $2.5 trillion in the trust fund. Social Security can pay out every benefit owed to every eligible American for the next 19 years. Social Security, because it's funded by the FICA tax, the payroll tax, which workers and employers contribute to, has not resulted in a nickel of deficit. Doesn't cause the deficit at all. So what they were telling is untrue, untrue, and untrue. But they were about to get away with it, because everybody is talking about the crisis in Social Security and how it's going bankrupt. Well, here's what we did. Some of us in the Senate, a few of us, formed a caucus called the Defending Social Security Caucus. And we reached out to senior groups all over this country, and I have mixed feelings about AARP. They're very large. Sometimes they do a good job, sometimes they don't. They were good on this issue. They were with us. National Committee to Defend Social Security and Medicare, right there. The American Retirement Association, good union people. We reached out to senior groups. We reached out to the AFL-CIO, Rich Trump, who was great on this issue. We reached out to every veterans organization in America representing millions of veterans. They were going to be hit hard. Disabled vets were going to see a cut in their COLAs. We reached out to women's groups. Women would be especially hit hard. We reached out to the disabled community. And hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people signed petitions, made telephone calls. And you know what happened? Today in Washington, nobody is talking about cutting Social Security. Now, that does not mean that the victory is permanent. That does not mean that our job is not only to defend against cuts in Social Security, our job is to expand Social Security benefits. But my point is, the way grassroots organizations came together to say to Washington, guess what? You're lying. We got it. You're not going to tell us that Social Security is going broke anymore. We understand the reality. And suddenly, Congress, Republicans, not talking about that issue anymore. Let me touch on a couple of other issues. I voted when I was in the House against the USA Patriot Act. And I voted against the reauthorization of the USA Patriot Act. And I did that not because I do not believe there are terrorist organizations out there who want to do us harm. They are, they're there, and they do want to do us harm. And I think we have got to be very, very vigilant in protecting ourselves against those people. But I have always believed that with strong, effective law enforcement and intelligence work, we can protect the American people without undermining the constitutional rights which make us a free society. So, now, one or two other issues. Just be brief about it, because I think you know this as well or better than I do. I sit on the Environmental Committee, and I sit on the Energy Committee. I'm the only member. I'm an independent, and I caucus with the Democrats. And I am the only person sitting on both of those committees. And we hear quite frequently from some of the leading scientists in the world who study climate change. And what I want you all to know is the debate is over. It's only on Fox TV where there's still a debate. The scientific community is absolutely clear. 97-98% of the peer-reviewed articles on the issue tell us climate change is real. It is caused by human activity in terms of drought, flooding, severe weather disturbances, forest fires, rising sea levels, etc. It is already causing devastating problems on this planet. It will only get worse unless we address that issue. And I got to tell you something. You know, you all know my politics, and I'm not a conservative Republican. I suppose you know that. But here's what is really disturbing. You know, I have different, you had, and I have differences with conservatives on a whole lot of issues. But we should not have a difference on science, right? There are some very smart Republicans out there. There are some physicians out there, and I talk to these guys. And we talk about issues like cancer, very serious problems, and other very serious health issues. And these guys read the literature, and they don't rant and rave about research in cancer or research in heart illness. They are scientists. They understand it, and they try to work with us to come up with good therapies. And yet, because of the power of the fossil fuel industry and the huge amounts of money they are capable of spending on campaigns and in advertising on media, there is supposedly a debate on this scientific issue. And we should be very, very embarrassed, really embarrassed, that a major political party in this country has rejected basic science. And if the Republicans gain control over the Senate, which some pundits think may happen, the chairman of the Environmental Committee, I believe, will be a fellow named Jim Inhofe of Oklahoma. You know Jim. And I know Jim. And Jim is actually a very nice guy. He's kind of a down-to-earth guy. But Jim believes, and he wrote a book on this, that climate change is a hoax, one of the greatest hoaxes ever perpetrated on the American people by Al Gore and the Hollywood elite and the United Nations. This may be the next chairman of the Environmental Committee, which has oversight over how we deal with climate change. All right, the last issue that I want to talk about may end up being more important than anything else, because it impacts everything else. And that has to do with a disastrous Citizens United Supreme Court decision. And more recently, the McCutcheon decision. And what those decisions are about is essentially our right-wing Supreme Court, by a 5-4 vote, and that we can talk about in a moment, and the significance of that. But by a 5-4 vote, what they said is essentially that corporations, Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan Chase, ExxonMobil, are good old people, just like you and me, and they have First Amendment rights to express their point of view, which means that they can spend an unlimited sum of money in the political process. That's what Citizens United is about. The reality of what that decision means is that the Koch brothers, Sheldon Adelson, and other billionaires, including some liberal types, are now spending huge amounts of money. And there is no equivalence here. The right wing is spending far more than liberals, but there are some liberals out there spending money. The result of all of that and where we are heading is that we are moving, in my view, toward an oligarchic form of society where not only do the billionaire class control our economy, but they increasingly control the political process. Now, if you think that Citizens United was bad, if you think McCutcheon was bad, let me tell you where the Republican Party now wants to go. And Clarence Thomas, in his opinion on McCutcheon, made this very clear. He said, and this has been the Republican plan from day one, he said we should eliminate all restrictions on campaign financing. What that means in a technical term is right now what the Koch brothers do is they can spend a zillion amount of money, amounts of dollars, independently. That means they can put ads on unlimited. What these guys now want to do, chairman of the Republican Party supports it, is to do away with all limits, which means that the Koch brothers can give unlimited sums of money directly to the candidate. They don't have to do independent expenditures. So if you're a right-wing candidate running here in Massachusetts, they call you in and they said, what do you need? Here's a check for $30 million. End of discussion. $50 million. We don't even have to do independent. You run the campaign. We'll buy everything for you. And this is their understanding of what democracy is supposed to be about. In my view, perhaps the most important effort that we have got to make is a constitutional amendment to overturn this disastrous Citizens United decision. Because if we don't, we are going to lose the foundations of American democracy and what people fought and died to protect. Now, here's some good news. I was just at a meeting 2 days ago. I have a constitutional amendment in. Other people have constitutional amendments in, and they have little modest differences of opinion. They've been written a little bit differently. What we're going to do now is get the best lawyers in the country to help us. We're going to create one piece of legislation. We're going to put it into the House. We're going to put it into the Senate. And we're going to get it on the floor. Not in the House, that we can't do. But we will get it on the floor of the Senate within the next couple of months. And what it will do, now right now, we have about, I may be wrong a little bit here, I think we have about 16 states. I don't know if Massachusetts is one of them or not. But we have about 16 states who have gone on record in saying they support a constitutional amendment. Vermont certainly has. We have something like 600 communities around the country who have also voiced their opinion. I believe that this is, A, an issue of unbelievable importance for all the reasons I gave you, but also it is a very effective organizing tool. Because on this issue, it is not just progressives who believe that Citizens United is a disaster. You got a lot of conservatives out there who understand that American democracy is not about allowing billionaires to buy elections. So we are going to bring something onto the floor as soon as we can, and we need huge amounts of grassroots activism around that issue. Now what I want to do, and I thank you for your patience, I've been going on for a while here, what I want to do is conclude my remarks by discussing with you something that you absolutely do not see on TV, and you're not going to see it on TV or on the New York Times soon. And that is, when we talk about campaign finance, I think the vast majority of Americans, no matter what their political view is, understand that there's something fundamentally un-American about billionaires being able to buy elections. That's across the political spectrum. But it is also important to understand what some of these guys who are spending hundreds of millions or billions of dollars, what do they believe? Why are the Koch brothers spending huge amounts of money? And you'll see in the New York Times, Koch brothers spend money, Harry Reid upset, blah, 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 blah. What you haven't yet seen, and I've been on the floor talking, I found it interesting. I've given 3 speeches on the floor of the US Senate, including one just on Thursday. Not one word of it has been picked up in the corporate media. And that is, what do the Koch brothers stand for? All right, it's one thing to know. It's not a good idea for anybody. I wouldn't like a liberal, progressive. I just don't think it's right. I believe in public funding of elections, by the way. But what do the Koch brothers believe? I mean, that's a pretty simple question. These guys are spending hundreds of millions. Maybe they'll spend billions. What do they believe? What do they want? It turns out, and I have a great staffer who I owe this to, in 1980, David Koch, one of the brothers, ran for Vice President of the United States on the Libertarian Party. And I don't disrespect people who run. I've run on third parties. Koch ran in 1980, Vice President. He helped fund the campaign. They got all of 1% of the vote. That's fine. I don't put that down. But I want to read to you what their platform was and to tell you, this is what I want you to follow. This is what they talked about in 1980. And the great issue, the great transition of American politics is how successful they have been by spending billions of dollars in a variety of ways in moving the Republican Party from what would be called a center-right party, the party of Dwight D. Eisenhower, to a right-wing extremist party. So I'm going to read you what was exactly word for word in their platform in 1980. And what you are going to recognize is that what was once considered to be kooky and crazy and extremist is to a significant degree mainstream Republican today. That is their success. And I'm going to read a number of planks. Take me a few minutes. First, quote, I'm quoting, this is the exact quote. Quote, we urge the repeal of federal campaign finance laws and the immediate abolition of the despotic Federal Election Commission, end quote. That was in 1980. Today, we are well on the way to achieving that goal. Chairman of the Republican Party today agrees that David and Charles Koch now have the right to spend as much money in any way they want in buying elections. Next, quote, we favor the abolition of Medicare and Medicaid programs, end of quote. Well, they haven't succeeded, but Paul Ryan's budget and Republican efforts in the House end Medicare as we know it and would convert Medicare into a voucher program. So this is their idea, that when you are 65, or they also want to raise the Medicare retirement age, 65 is much too young. So when you are 70 or whatever, we will give you a check for $8,000. And with that check, you can go any place you want, any private health insurance. And we know that if you have cancer or heart disease, the insurance companies will be just delighted to take you. And we know that your $8,000 check will last for at least a day and a half in any hospital in America. Good luck to you. So this is what the Koch brothers were talking about in 1980. This is where, in terms of Medicaid, they haven't talked about, well, you know what's going on. Massive cuts in Medicaid in the Ryan budget that would throw millions of people off of health insurance. You are aware that over 20 Republican governors have refused to accept Medicaid expansion through the Affordable Care Act. Quote, we favor the repeal of the fraudulent, virtually bankrupt, and increasingly oppressive Social Security system. Well, Bush made that effort a few years ago. But these guys have kind of backed away from that for the moment. But the idea of privatizing Social Security is out there. And you have some of the real right-wingers who believe that Social Security is unconstitutional. Federal government should not be involved in retirement. Now, listen to this one. This is a modest proposal. Quote, we support the eventual repeal of all taxation. Not much. In other words, we don't believe in government. And we want to go back to a society where government doesn't exist or barely exists, and those who got it, and those who don't are in a heap of trouble. Mentioned to you 2 weeks ago, we have fought to raise the minimum wage, and what is becoming increasingly apparent, although not apparent enough, is that it's not just that most Republicans do not want to raise the minimum wage, some may, but most don't, is that it more and more of them want to repeal the concept of the minimum wage. And that means, you see, and this is where, this is their ideology, and this is what all their think tanks about. If you want to live in a quote-unquote free society, you don't want that big, bad federal government to force your employer to pay you a minimum wage. You want the freedom to work for $3 an hour. So this is what they talked about in 1980. 1980 was called a crazy idea. When Dwight D. Eisenhower ran for president, he was proud. He mentioned that he raised the minimum wage. More and more Republicans now want to repeal the minimum wage. All right, listen to this. Quote, we advocate the complete separation of education and state. Government schools, generally regarded as public schools, government schools lead to the indoctrination of children and interfere with the free choice of individuals. Government ownership, operation, regulation, and subsidy of schools and colleges. All right. should be ended. Now, has that happened? Of course not. But are you hearing more and more people talking about the need to do away with public education, give vouchers to families to go to private schools? Yes. And they were talking about this back in 1980. It goes without saying, being in the fossil fuel industry, that they said, quote, "We support the abolition of the Environmental Protection Agency," end of quote. Whole lot, you're laughing. A lot of Republicans believe that. And if they can't get it, they want to defang the EPA. They have made the EPA a bogeyman. Every problem in the world, they run ads. The EPA is destroying the American economy. They don't. Over and over again, that's the success of the Koch brothers. Last one, there's many other points here. This is all up on my website, sanders.senate.gov. Last one, I want you to hear this one. Quote, "We oppose all government welfare, relief projects, and aid to the poor programs. All these government programs are privacy invading, paternalistic, demeaning, and inefficient." Listen to this. "The proper source of help for such persons is the voluntary efforts of private groups and individuals," end of quote. Do you know what that means? That's the end of food stamps. It's the end of nutrition programs. So if you put all of that, that's the end of all programs, extended unemployment benefits. They have a vision for America. And it's a vision not only to repeal every piece of legislation that has been passed since the 1930s to protect the kids, the elderly, the children, the sick, the poor, women, people with disabilities, all gone. And their vision of a free America is where a handful of billionaires stand on top, control the government, and if you're poor and hungry, maybe some charity may help you. Maybe they'll contribute. And that's your life. You are guaranteed nothing. The struggle over the history of the United States has been a struggle for rights, for dignity. That's what rights are. I'm an American. I am entitled to this, that, and that. I'm entitled to the right to vote. I'm entitled to, when I work in a factory, there is decent safety standards. I'm entitled to a minimum wage. And if I'm a woman, I'm entitled to equal pay for the work that I do. And if I'm gay, I am entitled not to be discriminated against. I am entitled because I'm an American citizen. And their entire effort is to decimate all of that progress made in the last 80 or more years and to bring us back to an extreme oligarchic society where these people control the economy, control the political life of the nation, and then dole out. I'm sure they'll give to charity, and if you can show them you're nice, they'll give you a few dollars. That's their vision of America. Now, that's something, and I just quoted right from their platform, word for word, you probably are not going to see too much of in the media. Really are not. Because it is, in a sense, I don't know why, it's too scary, it's too stark, it's too real. Media doesn't write about that stuff. But here is the good news. The good news is that agenda that I just gave you maybe reflects the views of 5-10% of the American people. That's about it. But the danger is that when you have people with unlimited power, unlimited money, and I mean unlimited, I mean, you have $80 billion, just, you know, if you were a passionate person and you had billions of dollars, you would spend it politically. They are passionate. They believe this stuff. They will spend it. A few billion means nothing to them. So when you have people with that kind of wealth, that kind of power, and people who are very radical in the sense that progressives are not. What the Koch brothers understood is that they gave up on the Libertarian Party and they gave up to it. They said, look, we have the money. We will create the think tanks, the Cato Institute, the Heritage Institute. We will create right-wing veterans groups. We will create right-wing healthcare think tanks. And we will give candidates that we support all the information they need. The talking points. You want to run for the United States Senate? I'm going to give you $30 million, and I'm going to give you your script on every single issue. And I'm going to have 5 professors and 10 think guys behind you feeding you this information. That's how they've done it. And they've done it in a radical way. They are changing not only are they putting money into politics, that we can understand, they're supporting the candidate, but they are spending money on think tanks, they're spending money on media. There was some discussion a couple of years ago about the Koch brothers buying the Chicago Tribune media company. They're putting money into radio. Right now, is Tom Hartman here? Where's Tom? Tom is here. Tom does a great job on radio. Tom and I have done a radio show for the last 7 years. But what Tom will tell you, and people like Tom, and not only Tom, Ed Schultz and many other guys, doing a great job, Randy Rhodes, many of them, what Tom will tell you is that 95% of talk radio is either right-wing or extreme right-wing. There are cities in America where people vote 80% against the Republicans, and yet you can't find a progressive voice. So this is what we are up against, and what the Koch brothers know, it's not just funding a candidate 2 months before the elections. It is in every sense, through media, through education. Do you hear every year, you hear this great debate going on about the elementary school books that are going to be produced for Texas? They understand that what's in textbooks influences kids. They are working, so they have this very broad, radical agenda of changing consciousness at every level, putting money into universities and colleges. And when you got the money, that's what they're doing. That is what we are up against. That's the bad news. The good news is that the overwhelming majority of the American people totally reject this agenda on every issue. When asked whether or not Social Security and Medicare should be cut, there was a poll a couple of years ago, Tea Party people said overwhelmingly no, et cetera, et cetera. So what do we have to do? What is the antidote to this? It's not easy. It is not easy. They have the money. They have direct media organizations, you know, like Fox and right-wing radio, and then they have the corporate media, which occasionally gives you 12 seconds to give you a point of view. But what we have to do is, in an unprecedented way, develop a strong grassroots network from California to Maine. And it means that everybody in this room and people who are not in this room have got to know that we are fighting for the life of America, that these are critical times, that ordinary people are going to have to become extraordinary people, that we're going to have to reach out and engage in a political way. And I believe, absolutely, that if we educate, if we organize, we're going to win this fight. We're going to win this fight. But it is not going to be easy. Not going to be easy. So I just, and in that sense, you know, let me just mention Tim again. Because the hard work that Tim did for his whole life is exactly what all of us have got to do. And it is hard work. It is hard work bringing people together. It is hard work going to meetings. It is hard work making sure that, you know, people who are 98% in agreement don't walk out of a room. That's the task we have. And this task is not just for the people in this room, not just for you, not just for my wife, Jane, not just for my 7 grandchildren. It is for the future of this great country. So I look forward to you. I thank you very much for the work you have done, and look forward to working with you in the years to come. Thank you all very, very much.